do have a choice along the Ulster Way. Well, you can use your own feet or someone else's. On foot or hoof, the Ulster Way takes you around 500 miles of Northern Ireland. In these programmes, we see this countryside through the eyes of the people who live the Ulster Way. We came here one summer's day and found more than an ancient fishing village. It was a festival day for Ardglass, and the work of making a living from the sea was to be put aside for a bit. Ardglass works hard, but there's the tang of the unusual and the exuberant mixed in with the salt breeze.
Andrew, small lemonade.
Sheets, cherries, fresh cream buns, meat pies, sausage rolls and cat food. And I'm named Matilda.
On festival day, it was to be smart gigs and water sports. Ardglass has a festival every year, and young poets do what they can.
The water sports in Ardglass were great this year. Everybody loved them, so I hear. The weather wasn't all that warm. It wasn't up to a summer norm. The sea was very fierce and rough. Whoever did the Ardtoil run was very tough. The ladder challenge was the best. It was better than all the rest.
The idea is to get to the top of the ladder, and the chap in the bottom can... The chap in the bottom can balance and use his weight. That's our first success.
The ancestors of the people here today defended their town from a savage tribe called the Fearbogs. It was the water around two sides of the town that held the Fearbogs at bay. So maybe that's why no one minds about falling in. Living beside the busy comings and goings of the fishing boats, there's a variety of human and animal life. Let's start with one Matilda, who is a turkey. Matilda was introduced to a washing machine, and she now prefers washing it to nearly anything else. How did Gwen Owens make her into a pet?
Up at the top of the Malone Road, there's a minister lives, and his wife phoned up, my husband's inspector in the council, and she phoned up and she said there was a big bird with no feathers or anything on chasing her about the garden. So he sent a man up to get her, and this was the one. Well, they brought her home to me and asked me if I want to cook her. And I am an animal lover, so I couldn't cook her, and I have her now a year in March there, and she became a pet. She goes away at the weekends down to the farm. She comes back home again on Sunday nights, and she goes away for her holidays and everything.
It's a critically important task. Recently, as John Oldham referred to, we've seen the outbreak.
Second
of
to the washing machine comes the television. But as you'll see, politicians have an odd effect on Matilda.
Sheets, cherries, fresh cream buns, meat pies, sausage rolls, and cat food.
Now the big event.
She's getting ready to lay an egg, so she's not interested in it. She's just laid the egg.
Well done, madam. Someone less frivolous, the harbour master of Ardglass, Ronan FitzSimmons.
Basically, as harbour master, my duty is to look after the upkeep, maintenance of the harbour, and collect any dues from landings from the fishing boats, also harbour dues, rents and rates for any property belonging to the harbour authority that's rented out, but and also to ensure that the boats have a safe berth. As you can see today, some of the boats are already in. The other half are out at sea. This one here has obviously come in because he's got some repair work to do. Something must have broken down, and he has a local engineer here to do a bit of maintenance. That's a local Ardglass boat called the Progress, owned by Angus Cochrane here. Fish is basically for prawns and whitefish. I find at times when they're repairing their nets especially, they're inclined to leave them on occasions lying around the harbour, and you have to go along later and say, look lads, we're trying to keep the place tidy, just don't leave them lying around. I always enjoyed the sea, of course, and anything associated with the sea, because I spent 16 years foreign going in the Merchant Navy before I came ashore here. So the sea is more or less, I would say, in my blood. I was reared in the village here and had always been associated with the fishing fleet from an early age. The fishermen themselves are very easy to get along with, and on occasions where they might come in and lie at the fish market, when they're not actually ready to land their catch, well then you've got to go and say to the boat, right, you must shift because there's another couple of boats coming in here and they're ready to land. But generally speaking, the men themselves, the skippers, they're very good. These boys are putting empty boxes on board, ready for next week's fishing. They've already taken, say, about 2 tons of ice. So it's a question just of tidying the ship, storing her up, and getting ready for heading off on Monday morning. Prices at the moment are high, so the men themselves are happy enough for that. This area here that we're just passing, that's the fish market. The boats land in on the other side of that. The boats come in from about 6 o'clock in the evening onwards, and they pull alongside the seaward end of the market itself. The gear that they use now is quite modern. The nets are the basic trawl net. As far as modern equipment is concerned, that can be found in the wheelhouse of the fishing vessels with the electronic aids and that they have now to actually catch the fish. It's not simply a case of just putting the net over the side and hoping they're going to get something. Their catch for the day is hoisted up onto the market, and the boxes are laid out in rows. All the various buyers assemble, and the auctioneer comes along and starts the bidding.
I sell for the boat, and it's up to me to get the best price I can for the boat. The better I do for the boat, the better I do for myself.
Right, on the wing, please. Come on, boys, I've got the tongue out. 750 on bid against the diddly, 760 for you. At 760, at 770, at 780, at 790, at 800, at 810, at 820, at 830.
When we walk into the market, and they'll all be well, whatever they are, and once they stop, it's like a poker school. Once you sit down to poker school, everyone's enemies. You get up, you walk over and have a drink. You don't discuss that again. It's exactly the same thing in the fish trade.
At 16, 10 and 20, 16,
30,
at 16, 40.
Ardglass has always been a good place to buy seafood. Harold Smith was bringing the price for prawns up to £32 per stone.
If you just look this way for me, please. And one last one, please. That's great.
And it was prawns that, for the highest catch of the week, brought a fine trophy for the winner. He was Tony ZYCH, being modest like mad.
Just look.
No, I think that one there would suit you better. About 18, do you?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, would you like it staked or left whole?
Oh, I like the steak. The tail cut off and the head cut off.
Okay. This is Cochrane's fish store, where Mrs. Cochrane with her husband started the business 20 years ago with a small stall.
Well, now, this customer wants his salmon and steaks, and she wants a piece of the tail left. So I'll just take the head off. Takes a good strong hand for this. Then I will put them into steaks.
The fish came straight from the quay, so they are renowned.
We bring our fish up every morning from the factory, fresh, and whatever's left over, it's put out and dumped. because we find that once people buy fresh fish every day, that's what they want. As you can see, these spots are red. When the place isn't so fresh, the spot, the red spot on it, is much duller than that one. And as you can see, that's nice and fresh.
Right, gentlemen, what would you like?
You have a bush, a harp, and a pint of harp.
A half indeed.
I like the atmosphere, and I like our glass, and I like the friendliness about it. And...
Oh, good crowd, and thank God. Good credit. Vodka, a bit of
vodka. Did you
say
the killer
wheel? Oh, no, I did not indeed. You were out. I was working while you were talking about it.
They really pull your leg unmercifully. It's more, and they don't anger you. It's more part of the fun of the day. You know, they're in good humour, but come in and they're quite merry and they'll tell you a few stories. And they, oh, if you make a mistake, that's it for the end of the end of the day. It's the day you leave our last.
Did you want lemon in your vodka?
Please. Ardglass has a very rich history, which is evident in all the castles that we see around us. This one here, known as Cowd's Castle, extending through the building that's now known as Ardglass Castle, that is the home of the golf club. In the centre of the town, Jordan's Castle, and quite close by here, Margaret's Castle. It's hard to believe that this run-down area that I'm in at the moment, back in the reign of Henry IV in the 1400s, was a scene of great activity. For it was here, in fact, that it was the maritime port. This, if you like, was the Oxford Street of London. We had 32 units, rooms where the trading took place. And one can still see the only part that's genuine of the period still in existence, the square-headed doors and windows. And here, one has to imagine the area piled high with animal hides, which the Irish were exporting, particularly to Cheshire and England. In return, the import of iron and salt and cotton and fine silks were exchanged and traded. And from this building, we move along to the military aspect of this trading colony. One can still see the castellated tops and the wall walk, all that remains. The soldiers were on top, keeping guard against possible attack from the native Irish, which surrounded this English colony town. And from the wall walks, one then can see what remains of the gun loops from where the English soldiery would have fired their guns in the time of local attack. Now, coming along, one can still see the third tower, all that remains from the lookout overlooking the Irish Sea across to England, and the Norman arch covering the doorway from which you gained access to the top. And the blocked up archway, which was really the main route from the harbour below, in came the carts taking the produce in and the hides back out to the ships. And whilst all this was going on, there was the normal hustle and bustle of a little compact unit. There was the drinking of the sailors intermingled with the traders, the wenching that took place. We know this did happen in the alcoves behind us here.
On boats, by boats, with boats comes naturally an Ardglass. The festival included races between fairly grand model ships, some more than 100 years old. On the waterfront, Kevin McGee was a contender.
Well, it's a very old skill. Like, here years ago in Ardglass, there used to be maybe about 40, 50 yachts, and every Sunday they used to race, because there was very little to do in those days, like, you know. All they had was, the recreation they had was just going out sailing yachts or playing football or something together. So they took up this business here of racing yachts. You set this bim here, you can let it out or bring it in, like, you know. If you want to run right up into wind, you have it tight. If you want to run downwind, you let it off slack. Yeah, okay. But you look at the modern day yacht today, much similar to us here. You watch these boats that raced in the Admiral Cup and that. The hulls are all exactly like us here. So these boys in those days knew what they were doing, like, you know.
They're at the speed of this main one now. That's my yacht there. They're at the speed of that.
And as for speed, I don't think they've ever been tested how fast they can really go, but they are very fast. Like, four men rowing a boat, it's very hard to catch them.
That boat sails well when she's tightened down, doesn't she?
Too
slack on the jibs and too slack on the mainsail. See, when the wind eases, this boat comes round. That boat's staying much straighter course.
We'll have to order that one again for next year, Captain.
The trophy's mine.
Coming up again now.
John, the trophy's mine.
The old boys used to do, if the yacht wasn't going right, they used to cut it in half and make another one. See if we can get one faster, you know. Design the sail maybe a wee bit different or something. Try something like that there, like, you know. Go ahead a wee bit, John. That's beautiful there, the day now for that, isn't it? Hold on, I'm the winner. I'm the winner. I'm the winner.
Around Ardglass not so long ago, ponies and gigs were a common sight. All classes made use of them. To go to church, school, to go to town, to go to market. A lot of retired people like Mr. Ford have taken up showing their ponies and gigs in the area. The Ardglass Festival Committee persuaded more than 20 enthusiasts to polish their harness, brush up the gloss on the pony, dust and repaint the wagon. The ponies are held in high esteem.
Very fond of them. The wife said, I think, more of the horse than they do of her. There was always a good turnout of ponies, but they're coming back here very quick now. They definitely are. That wee gig there now, that gig's going into its third generation. They reckon that gig's about 2,500 years of age. Postman used that gig for delivering the post in them days, all up around the Mourne Mountains.
Mr. Ford had brought his pony from Belfast for the day out, and both headed for the showground. Dick McGee, another man enthused. What made it such fun?
Well, getting out and meeting people, doing things for charity. There's such a thing. I have great fun out of it. Marvellous. Get a great pleasure out of it. Driving and talking to different people, meeting different people, different ponies all around the whole country. I waited a long time to have a pony in trap. Waited over 30 years.
Ponies have to have a good character. Nothing known against them, as they say. It's not just a matter of looking smart. A pony has to behave in traffic and be completely safe. Who owned them in the old days?
All local people of all classes. If they could manage it at all, that was their transport. Pony in trap.
They all made it to the showground. In far-off days, there were fighting horses stabled near here. Then the locals had to stay awake. They were besieged by tribes who wanted the fine produce of this trading port. The fighting horses have gone. In place, a hobby with ponies that seems to be gaining popularity.
It is. I would say it is, and I say it is. We've only started a club across in Killoch this year, and over 20 members that actually own ponies, and I've also a few members that are non-driving members, what we call non-driving members.
Now, back to the harbour where Willie Williams remembers the old days and how he met his wife among the herring barrels.
Ardglass has been the premier fishing port way back, way right back into the late 1800s. All this harbour was completely covered up with barrels. The big open troughs were lying, which were called farlands. And the girls all stood around them. You'd have about 12 girls at this farland. There was three girls in a crew, two girls doing the gutting and one girl behind them doing the packing. I picked my wife from one of them. They were very nice, good-looking girls. They just turned us young boys. Our heads were turned, and we used to gather up to the fishermen's rest at night. We came down there and we had hymn singing, and various fishermen among the crowd of men would have spoken at these meetings, and we had a great time at an interval for tea.
They generally go off in the morning about 4 o'clock, about 20 to 30 miles off Ardglass, between here and the Isle of Man. Fish for prawns and whitefish, land into the market at about 6:30 at night.
As a rule, there's nothing on the Ardglass bank. You might just get small plaice, which nobody wants, you know. We have to go farther afield, so maybe a couple of hours steam, you know, to get any decent fishing in. If we got the decent weather, we'd have plenty of good fishing, you know, but at the moment the weather's been bad all the time.
The herring season has just finished, so from now on through till about next May, it'll be for prawns, whitefish, cod, turbot, plaice, generally whitefish.
Shooting the net can be dangerous.
If you're shooting the net in the morning with it gone out, you have to stand well clear of it, just to make sure you know it goes out with it. If there's any wind at all there, it goes out with a great authority, you know.
Skippers of the Ardglass boats are from many places. The family that owns several boats is headed by a refugee from Poland. He's known for keeping a good crew and keeping the tipple inside the pub.
Well, every man knows his job, and no alcohol on the ship, you know. Nobody comes drunk, and you have that problem. If you had any drink on the ship, you know, it's dangerous for start, but we have none of that problem, you see, yeah.
Mrs. ZYCH watches and waits by the harbour, for these seas around Ardglass can be rough. On board the Pathway, Rodney Harding has the net out and solves problems for his four-man crew.
Get Ronnie to make you a pair.
An hour
or so. They go straight to bed in the morning, you know, and get as much sleep as they can. But after the first door, as a rule, they're on the deck all day. They just stood there tailing prawns and sorting fish out, you know. And by the time they've finished that, it's time to lift the nets again for the next tow, you know. Came to Ardglass on a fishing boat, you know, a small boat. And I liked Ardglass, so I got myself a job with one of the local boats. That was 13 years ago. And I've been here ever since. I work for somebody. The boat stops.
There's a snag on the seabed. So will the net come free? It wasn't a long trawl, but the net is loose, damaged and coming up. And with it, just a portion of the livelihood of the home port. The fishing village that is called Green Mound in the old town. Ardglass at the edge of County Down.